This evening at the Granada Forum, we welcome presidential candidate Ted Gunderson. As regards his background, he is a former special agent in charge of Los Angeles office of the FBI. He served there for 27 and a half years. In 1979, he founded the Ted L. Gunderson and Associates. It's a Santa Monica-based firm doing international security consulting and investigation. F. Lee Bailey, Esquire, the famous attorney, once described Ted Gunderson as a person with investigative skills that are unsurpassed by anyone I know or have known. Tonight he will be speaking on his recent experiences on the campaign trail as a Democratic candidate for President of the United States. We'll hear about his platform and plan to return America to the constitutional government. Additionally, he'll talk about the Oklahoma City bombing, Satanism, child abduction, and drug running. Now, please join me in giving Ted a warm welcome.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. It's a pleasure being here. And, you know, I kind of changed my lecture around driving up here today, and I just prepared something brand new. I'm getting kind of tired of the drugs in Oklahoma City. Maybe we can go into that in the question and answer. In fact, I welcome it. But several years ago, I gave a lecture in Las Vegas. And after the lecture, a man walked up to me without identifying himself, without introducing himself, and he said, "I want to present this to you. I want you to understand what you're combating and what the problems are in this country at the very lowest level and at the highest level, too." And he handed me this book. It's called Pawns in the Game. And this book is written by William Guy Carr, and he's a retired commander. And basically what it is, it's a story about the secret government, the shadow government, the Illuminati. And for a long time I've thought, you know, I think that we should all know about that. And that's something that oftentimes on the radio shows they don't want you to get into because people seem to be afraid of it. And many of the announcers and the hosts don't like to get into too many controversial matters. What do you want me to do? Oh, hold it up? Sure. So what I'd like to do tonight, and we'll discuss those other matters, Oklahoma City bombing and my political career, which so far has been very exciting and very interesting, in the question and answer, if we may. By the way, okay, take it down? Thank you. Okay. How long a program do we want, would we like to have here tonight? Can somebody tell me so I can kind of time it?
Hour and 15.
Okay. When the bell goes off at 9:15, why, if you want to just get up and walk out, I'll understand. Okay. But let's talk about the Illuminati. After all, based on everything that I've been able to come up with and research, really that's the very essence of the problem in this country today and around the world, really. And it was founded on May the 1st, 1776, by Adam Weishaupt. He was a German. And the basic philosophy of the Illuminati was superior beings with superior intelligence have the right to rule those less gifted because the masses don't know what is best for them. That sounds kind of like an interesting situation. And so I'm going to just kind of go to the book, and then we're going to go back to real practical experiences, and then we're going to go back and forth. We're going to kind of pick this book apart. I think it'll be an interesting lecture. First time, as I said, I prepared this coming up from Las Vegas, so I told my friend Bob Duffy over here, "Bob, if it's too dry, just tell me I won't give it again, okay?" But anyway, Weishaupt organized the Illuminati to put the plot into execution. The words Illuminati is derived from Lucifer and means holder of the light. Using the lie that his objective was to bring about a one-world government to enable men with proven mental ability to govern the world, he recruited about 2,000 followers. And these included the most intelligent men in the field of the arts and letters, education, the science, finance, and industry. He then established lodges in the Grand Orient to be their secret headquarters. And Weishaupt's revised plan required his Illuminati to do the following things to help him accomplish their purpose. Number one, use monetary and sex bribery to obtain control of people already occupying positions in high places in the various levels of all governments and other fields of human endeavor. Once an influential person had fallen for the lies, deceits, and temptations of the Illuminati, they were to be held in bondage by application of political and other forms of blackmail and threats of financial ruin, public exposure, and physical harm, and even death to themselves and to their loved ones. Now, I became involved in the Jeffrey R. McDonald case. I'm sure many of you remember that case. And that was my first exposure to the Illuminati. Within 10 months of entering the case, I obtained a signed confession from Helena Stokely, the Jeffrey R. McDonald case. Is there anybody that does not remember that case? He's a former Green Beret doctor who was convicted of murdering his wife and two children. February 17, 1970, Fort Bragg, North Carolina. He didn't do it. October 25, I obtained a confession from Helena Stokely, right down here in Westwood in my office. And at that time, she said that Dr. McDonald did not commit those crimes. Those crimes were committed by my satanic cult group. And being, as I'd been in the FBI 27 and a half years, almost 28 years, I believe it or not, I really didn't know anything about Satanism or about satanic activity. That was my first exposure to it. And since then, believe me, in researching and in, as a matter of practical experience, I've run across it time and time again. So the first phase of Mr. Weistrop's proposal was drugs and sex and blackmail, right? Well, in the last 16 years I've been involved in this field, I just have a few headlines here. Washington Times, power broker served drugs, sex at parties, bug for blackmail. Homosexual prostitution probe and snarls officials of Bush and Reagan, Washington Times again. Top Japanese politician linked to Spence, that's Craig Spence. Craig Spence was a CIA operative whose specialty was to set up and blackmail prominent politicians, dignitaries, ambassadors, and so forth. And once they were blackmailed, then, of course, our government, mainly the CIA, for the most part, had them in their hip pocket. So that's a very common thing. And also, I've run across this situation in a Nebraska case. I became involved in the Nebraska case. It's called the Franklin cover-up in late 1989. And as a result of my investigation and working with John DeCamp, we developed information about children who were being taken out of private schools in Omaha, boys and girls, by private limousine to Sioux City, Iowa, 120 miles away, placed on private jets and flown to Washington, D.C. for sex orgy parties with congressmen and senators and prominent politicians, governors, and ambassadors. So these kids, some of these children were also taken to the Republican National Convention in New Orleans and also in Dallas, Texas. It's a typical situation. Now, when it comes time to vote on a particular bill, and somebody comes around and says, I want you to vote this way because you remember we were at that party the other day and there was that 10-year-old kid back in the bedroom with you, how do you think he's going to vote, right? And I might mention that the kids all placed George Bush at one of those parties when he was vice president. Our George Bush, which doesn't surprise me, of course. Okay, the next point in question with this, the Illuminati and Mr. Weissop's ideas, is the Illuminati on the campuses and on the faculties of colleges and universities to recommend students possessing exceptional mental ability, belonging to well-bred families with international learnings for special training in internationalism. This training was to be provided by granting scholarships to those selected. They were to be educated and indoctrinated into accepting the idea that only one world government can put an end to recurring wars and tribulations. They were to be at first persuaded and then convinced that men of special ability and brains had the right to rule those less gifted, because the goyim, meaning the masses of the people, didn't know what is best for them physically, mentally, and spiritually. And then it goes on and it mentions the three specific schools. And then the third point in his platform was to influence influential people trapped into coming under the control of the Illuminati. The students had to be especially educated and trained, were to be used as agentur and placed behind the scenes of all governments as experts and specialists, so they could advise the top executives to adopt policies which would, in the long run, serve the secret plans of the one-worlders and bring about the ultimate destruction of the governments and religions they were elected or appointed to serve. Now let's think back to Franklin Delano Roosevelt. You remember his Secretary of State? What was his name? I was trying to think of it. Cordell Hull. And just recently, well, it wasn't Cordell Hull, was he? Huh? No, it was the, he was, he's been, a, it's been documented since the Soviet Union. I can't think of his name. Stenson? No, it wasn't it. Anyway. No, that wasn't it either. Well, Wolf, I'll tell you, recently I was trying to think about this coming up, and I couldn't think of his name. I'll find out for the next lecture, by the way. Well, he wasn't secretary, he was a top advisor, and he went with him to Yalta, Franklin Delano Roosevelt to Yalta. Yes, yes. And it's been documented since the fall of the wall, the Berlin Wall, it's been documented that Alger Hiss was, in fact, a Soviet spy. And look what we gave away at Yalta. So this is typical. The fourth point, the Illuminati were to obtain control of the press and all other agencies which distribute information to the public. News and information was to be slanted so that the Goyim would come to believe that a one-world government is the only solution to our many and varied problems. Well, I don't probably have to talk to you much about the one-world control press, because that's exactly what they are. And I've had some experience on the campaign trail in that regard. In late November, I decided to run for President of the United States. I'd been a Republican all my life. But I felt that to be the most effective candidate, I should, for the first time, register as a Democrat, and I did. And as a result, I went to a number of Democratic rallies, and I publicly stated how I felt, and I was not too popular. I was kind of like the bastard at the family reunion, if I may say. And as a matter of fact, I remember in Galveston, I stood behind this fellow we were registering, and I introduced myself and told him I was running for president on the Democratic ticket. I told him he had a choice. He had a conservative Democrat, a Jeffersonian Democrat, or Bill Clinton. He said, I've already decided to vote for my friend Bill. I said, well, let me talk to you a little bit about you. I don't want to talk to you. Well, I don't want to talk to you. I tried it four times, and he wouldn't let me get one word in. So that was kind of typical of what happened to me. But at that same rally, there was a judge who was master of ceremonies. And after the program was over, and Richard Gebhardt spoke there, by the way. And after the program was over, I went up and shook hands with the judge, and he very quietly said, I have to say that I admire what you're doing. And but he also said, don't tell anybody I told you that. New Hampshire. In New Hampshire, the first press release that came out gave Clinton as 94% of the vote. And the rest of us all had 6%. Now, I registered in New Hampshire, and unfortunately, I was not able to even make a trip to New Hampshire because my finances were so tight. But I did end up 11th out of 21 candidates, so there's somebody up there that knows about me anyway. In checking behind the scenes, so to speak, I learned that the truth of the matter was that Bill Clinton received 91%, the rest of us received 6%, and 3% of the people took their ballots and didn't vote for anybody. So that's, of course, one of the ways that they do it. Austin, Texas, one Sunday here a couple of Sundays ago, they had a rally at the State Capitol building for the Branch Davidians. And I was asked to appear there as a speaker, make a few comments. I was about the fourth or fifth speaker, I was the fifth speaker, as a matter of fact, and They had some of the victims and some of the victims who were able to get out of there. One man, I felt so sorry for him, he lost his 18-year-old daughter. He was also there and was able to get out. They had the relatives of the victims and so forth. And I was the last speaker. And when I got up to speak, a CBS affiliate there took the cameras down and walked off. And so I started talking about some of the problems we have in this country, you know, little things like billions of dollars of drug money laundered through BCCI and a savings and loan fiasco where people lost their whole life savings, and Ruby Ridge and Waco. And I felt that the media should at least be aware of it, since they don't ever print anything about those various items. And they just kept on walking. And finally, I just said, you know, ladies and gentlemen, you've been betrayed and we've been betrayed. We've been betrayed by the White House. We've been betrayed by Congress. We've been betrayed by the politicians. And worst of all, we've been betrayed by the American press and by the American media. I pointed at them. I said, this is the perfect example. They were walking off to the left. And they turned around, stopped, and looked at me, and I signaled them out. In Iowa, just the other day, I don't know if you're aware of this or not. If it even came over on the news service, Peter, I don't know if it did or not, but I heard about it through my sources. The precinct captains in Iowa were given instructions to call the results of each of their precincts to the voter news service first and foremost. Now, the voter news service is made up of representatives from CBS, NBC, ABC, CNN, and the Associated Press. And they did that, just that. And I also heard through various sources that on that particular day, there were 8 primaries. This was a caucus in Iowa, of course, but there were a total of 8, including this caucus. And in Iowa, in the 6 of the 8, the precinct captains, the Republican precinct captains, were given the same instructions. They can't prove it in the other 5 because they were all using computers, and it's impossible to determine if a computer is accurate or not after the fact. There's no way to go back and check on it. But in the Iowa situation, they went back and they found out that they shaved 13% of the votes off of Buchanan. And I understand that story was broken in the Manchester Union Leader, which is a Republican paper in Manchester, well-known paper. But I didn't see it any place, and I've been trying to be alert for it. Did it come across the news service? Okay. That's typical of the American media and the American press. Now, let's talk a little bit about the computers. And this something absolutely has to be done about these electronic voting machines. John DeCamp, a good friend of mine, an attorney in Lincoln, Nebraska, was running for governor of the state of Nebraska in the last election. A week before the election, he was first in the polls. First time in the history of the Omaha World Herald, by the way, that they had never published the results of the polls. Now, there's a reason for that, because John DeCamp had identified one of the main perpetrators in the Nebraska Franklin cover-up case as Harold Anderson, former publisher of the Omaha World Herald. And of course, Bob Wadman, chief of police, was one of the individuals identified by the children. And Eugene Mahoney, head of the Nebraska Forestry Service, was identified. And 2 other very prominent citizens there in Lincoln. But he ended up in the election coming in third. He was leading the week before, ended up in third. He checked in, John and his associates, his people, checked into the computer system. And basically, the way that it works is this way. The ballots are put into the box at each location, and then 2 people from each party at each machine, and 1 person from the elected committee is at that machine also. Now, they run, say, 120 ballots through the machine just as a sample. And if they all check out, then they continue to run the rest of them. And they say, well, this machine is all right because the 120 were accurate. But the trouble is they can set those machines so that starting with number 139, somebody else gets the vote. And in fact, there's a lady in New Orleans who, after the election, she was defeated. After the election, she went down and personally checked the machine. She punched her name, and the vote came up as her opponent's vote. So Something has to be done. I think they need to outlaw those. Speaking of drugs, and as we're talking about basically the Illuminati, I'm going to mention one of the programs that's being used by a clandestine group of U.S. government operatives, primarily the CIA. It's called the Black Rose. And it has for many years run illegal drugs and arm operations both Southeast Asia via the Golden Triangle and the Middle East via the Golden Crescent, founded by the British socialist-based Russell Trust drug cartel. The Black Rose, current chairman and co-founder, is an individual known as the White Rose, or GHWB, also known as, better known as George Bush. Indeed, it was Bush who, as top member of the Skull and Bone Society, developed the heroin ring, which serviced as ambassador along with his CIA activities. The Black Rose also ran cocaine through Panama from Colombia to the offshore oil rigs in the Gulf of Mexico, all owned by the Bush family, the Zapata Oil Company. Don't mean to pick on George Bush, but I'll get around to Clinton in a few minutes, okay? My point here is I don't think there's a dime's worth of difference between the Republicans and the Democrats. Sorry, Betty. I have a very prominent Republican lady sitting right down here who's a dear friend of mine. Past president of the Ladies Republican Club, right, Betty? I remember I spoke to him when I was in the FBI. But she's not one of them, though, I guarantee you that. But we really have some problems in this country, and I don't think there's that much difference between Bush, Dole, or Clinton, all the three of them. And I'm going to discuss Dole a little bit later on. But anyway, in a subsequent meeting of the Illuminati on July the 16th, 1982, they came up with a seven-part goal. Now listen to this closely. They came up with the order of chaos. Create chaos in your society, in your home. Abolishment of private property. Abolishment of inheritance. Abolishment of patriotism. Abolishment of all religions. Abolishment of the family. And creation of a new world order. I'm going to just give you next a little summary of the Communist Manifesto. 1. Abolishment of private property. Heavy progressive income tax. Abolishment of all rights of inheritance. Confiscation of property of all immigrants and rebels. A central bank. Government control of communication and transportation. Government ownership of factories and agriculture. Government control of labor. Cooperative farms, regional planning. Government control of education. Let's go back to the book now. Now in 1773, when Meyer Rothschild was only 30 years of age, he invited 12 other wealthy and influential men to meet him in Frankfurt. His purpose was to convince them that if they agreed to pool their resources, they could then finance and control the world revolutionary movement and use it as their manual of action to win ultimate control of the wealth, natural resources, and manpower of the entire world. During this meeting, this was recorded, by the way. There were 26 various points, topics that were discussed, but I'm just going to skip through a few of them that I think apply to our situation here today. And during this meeting, it was discussed, and he argued that the use of any and all means to reach their final goal was justified on the grounds that the ruler who governed by the moral code was not a skilled politician because he left himself vulnerable and in an unstable position on the throne. He said those who wish to rule must have recourse to cunning and to make-believe because great national qualities like frankness and honesty are vices in politics. Okay, item number 4. Item number 8, I'm skipping through because it'd be too long if I read them all. Okay. He next advocated that the use of, listen to this, alcohol, drugs, moral corruption, and all forms of vice be used systematically by their agenteurs to corrupt the morals of the youth of the nation. He recommended that the special agenteurs should be trained as tutors, governesses, clerks, and by women in the places of dissipation frequented by the goyims. That's the mass of the people, by the way. He added, quote, in the number of these last, I count also the so-called society ladies who become voluntary followers of the others in corruption and luxury. We must not stop at bribery, deceit, and treachery when they should serve towards the attainment of their end, of our end. So we talk about drugs. And is it not obvious what's going on in this country? What about Iran-Contra, arms for drugs? I personally have talked to two CIA pilots who were involved in the drug operation. You know, one of them spoke here recently, Terry Reed. Another one's a good friend of mine in Dallas, Texas. And why neither one of these people have been suicided, I will never know. But the one in Dallas has been sent to jail, and the attempts were made on his life once he was in the prison. So our friend Bill Clinton was fully aware of the situation in Arkansas when he was governor. In fact, the MENA Arkansas operation lasted for at least 10 years. It was personally brought to his attention by Larry Nichols. I think some of you heard Larry Nichols last night. But Bill Clinton told Larry, well, it's not a state matter, it's a federal matter. The Arkansas Redevelopment Authority was designed by Bill Clinton and some of his colleagues, and every loan that was supposed to have been made for the churches and the schools and the students, every loan was personally signed by Bill Clinton. This is documented in Clinton Chronicles, and the most recent of which is Clinton Chronicles 2. Have any of you seen Clinton Chronicles 2? It's available. Do we have any back there? It is available, I think, at our table. There may be somebody else is selling it also. But there's no question about the MENA Arkansas situation. In that 10-year period, there was not one confiscation of an automobile, a railroad, or an airplane with drugs, and there was not one conviction, in spite of the fact that the governor of the state of Arkansas, Bill Clinton, knew fully well about the operation. The police officers who attempted to investigate the case were either reassigned, and some of Bill Clinton's personal security guards, one in particular, was murdered. And five of the security men said that on at least 100 occasions, Bill Clinton was involved with at least 100 different women. In other words, he's a womanizer. As Congressman Denemeyer said, he's a womanizing, draft dodging. What was that? Spot smoking. Liar. Pathological liar. Pathological liar. And he should be impeached. And I'll have to go along with that. Now, what about the CIA? Well, I first ran into CIA drug operations and also Army drug operations, again, going right back to the Jeffrey R. McDonald case. I couldn't believe that they were bringing drugs, and I was kind of a Boy Scout, I guess, being in the FBI. It was a good organization then. I was apple pie, Chevrolet, and all that, and very patriotic. I still am, of course. But I couldn't believe that our boys who died for us in the Southeast were being used, their body cavities were used, by placing drugs in plastic bags and being brought into this country by Army personnel, top-ranking officers, police officers involved in the Jeffrey McDonald case, at least two attorneys. And by the way, this is documented in Time Magazine, January 1, 1973. And then the Nugenhan Bank was set up in Sydney, Australia, specifically to launder money coming out of Southeast Asia in the 60s and the early 70s. And then we had BCCI. And who's behind this, primarily? The CIA. The CIA. I've talked to CIA agents who told me that we make other terrorists in the country look like a Sunday school class, that we are the most treacherous terrorists active in the world today, the CIA is. I don't know if you're aware of MK Ultra, the mind control program, or if you're aware of some of these other operations that the CIA has. I have a whole list of them. It'd take me 2 hours if I started reviewing them with you. But this is disgraceful. Disgraceful, not only as human beings, but also as a democratic organization and country. We're actually a totalitarian country, as far as I'm concerned. Okay, so we have drugs, and then the next item that on the agenda in the book says, number six, he then admonished his listeners with these words, quote, "The power of our resources must remain invisible until the very moment when it has gained such strength that no cunning or force can undermine it." He warned them that any deviation from the line of the strategical plan he was making known to them would risk bringing to naught the labors of centuries. That pretty well speaks for itself. I think that the Illuminati and this evil element in our society has been very good, mainly through control of the media, in not alerting the American people as to what the underlying problems are in this particular area. And that's all organized. And then item number nine, turning to politics, he claimed, this is at that meeting now, remember? He claimed that they had the right to seize property by any means and without hesitation if by doing so they secure submission and sovereignty. He pronounced, quote, "Our state marching along the path of peaceful conquest has the right to replace the horrors of war by less noticeable and more satisfactory sentences of death necessary to maintain the terror which tends to produce blind submission." Are you familiar with Dianne Feinstein's federal land takeover? Right? I know you are. Are you familiar with the laws that allow our alphabet teams, BATF, FBI, and others to come in and seize assets? Are you aware that there's a statute? I haven't seen this with my own eyes yet. I've been told this. And when I say it's true because I've documented it or I've had the research on it. This I don't have the research on. I've been told there was a statute passed recently that allowed the federal government to seize land and additional criminal charges, misdemeanors other than mainly drugs, which is what they've used in the past. I know of individual after individual who's lost their land, lost their property. So this kind of follows with the pattern. There's a financial crimes enforcement network active in the country today. And it's a little known agency within the Treasury Department whose subversive mission is to monitor every dime you earn, track every dollar you spend, and identify all your assets and property for later confiscation. They haven't been doing too well with me lately, I'll tell you. That's the way they keep you down and out, is they keep you broke. And then there's a international biofear reserves, it is. In the New World Order, this team for a section of land that has been turned over to the World Conservation Bank in lieu of payment of the debt to the World Bank. In the U.S., largely unknown to most Americans, many beautiful national parks and wilderness are quietly being turned over to the World Bankers, the Rothschilds, and the Rockefellers cartel as payment on the national debt. Areas such as Smoky Mountain National Park, these are then cleared of any citizens and zealously patrolled by U.S. Forestry Services. By the way, most recently I learned that in recent years, U.S. Forestry Services are now carrying firearms. They didn't used to carry firearms in the old days. In fact, the entire Amazon basin of Brazil is now the property of the Prime Philip of England, who heads the International Biosphere Reserve for the World Conservation Bank. This is happening all over the world, ladies and gentlemen. Item number 11. He next expounded his theories regarding war. In 1773, he set down a principle which the governments of Britain and the United States publicly announced as their joint policy in 1939. Now, wait a minute, this is 1773, and he talked about a war in 1939? This is documented, ladies and gentlemen. He said it should be the policy of those present to foment wars, but to direct the peace conferences so that neither of the combatants obtain territorial gains. Yalta, I'd say. I think the Russians came out far ahead of us. He said the war should be directed so that the nations engaged on both sides would be placed further in their debt and in the power of our agents. Wars. These are the people that tell us when we go to war. These are the people, the World Bank, the silent bank, the behind-the-scenes agency, World Bank, Federal Reserve, you name it. They're the ones that tell us who's going to be in the White House, who's going to be elected. And if they can't get them in the White House, they can always just not have a primary like we did in Kansas recently with Bob Dole, right? If it doesn't look too good for him. Okay, number 12. He next dealt with administration. He told those present that they must use their wealth to have candidates chosen for a public office who would be obedient to our commands, this is in quotes, so they may readily be used as pawns in our game by the learned and ingenious men we will appoint to operate behind the scenes of government as official advisors. He added that the men we appoint as advisors will have been bred, reared, and trained from childhood in accordance with our ideas to rule the affairs of the whole world. Well, I just mentioned the Nebraska case. They're running kids back there, blackmailing politicians. I recall another case as a result of the McDonald investigation. I became a so-called satanic expert and have testified as an expert witness on satanic cult matters. I recall a lady in New York City came to me, and she had been in the cult, had been raised in the cult as a multi-generation member of the satanic cult group, her mother and father, grandmother, and so forth. And she was sent to law school specifically to learn about immigration into this country, that she was an immigration attorney. And she told me herself that she used to make trips to Europe to pick up children and bring them into Kennedy Airport and turn the children over to two men, a man and a woman, who she had never even seen before. Item number 13, he dealt with propaganda and explained how their combined wealth could control all outlets of public information while they remained in the shade and clear of blame, regardless of what the repercussions might be due to the publications of libel, slander, or untruths. The speaker said, thanks to the press, we have got gold in our hands, notwithstanding the fact that we had to gather it out of the oceans of blood and tears, but it has paid us even though we have sacrificed many of our own people. Each victim on our side is worth 1,000 goyims. Propaganda, libel, slander. In the Nebraska case again, the children have identified Warren Buffett as being involved in this operation, this ring. Warren Buffett's the richest man in America. Warren Buffett is a major stockholder, ABC Television. Warren Buffett is a major stockholder in the Washington Post. I recall recently speaking to the media after the Oklahoma City bombing. I was interviewed by Nightline, NBC. Is that Nightline or Dateline, Peter? Nightline. Yeah. And Chris Hansen interviewed me, and the producer was Italian named Joe, I forget his name offhand. Anyway, they had me come over to the hotel in Las Vegas. They came to Las Vegas. And I went over and we sat down, and they interviewed me for 2.5 hours. And they kept asking me the same question over and over and over. One question they must have asked me 10 or 12 times. And I've been dealing with the media for about 25 or 30 years. So I knew what he was doing. He's waiting for me to give the weakest answer or a poor answer or a different answer so that they could discredit me. And this happens to me on a regular occasion. After Chris Hansen finished, I don't know if any of you saw that, the final product, but they tried to make me look like an idiot on national television. I don't think they succeeded. I was told they didn't. The producer said to me, and there had just been an article in Spotlight magazine about how I talked about the Oklahoma City bombing. It was the big lie, which it still is, and I still claim it is, and I know it is. And John Doe, too, by the way, is either a government agent or an operative. There's no question about it. I'll be glad to tell you why I think that later on, the questions and answers. And the producer said, okay, Chris was through. He said, Mr. Gunderson, would you tell us about your alignment with Spotlight magazine? I said, I'm not aligned with anybody. I said, I will talk to any member of the press if he wants to interview me. After all, I'm talking to you, aren't I? And Chris, I recall, he kind of grinned a little bit. But that was typical. And they were there specifically to try to discredit me, to embarrass me. There's no question about it. The other two people they put on, a fellow named Jackson, who was an ex-con, and the Thompson, I think, was the Thompson lady. Van, you remember the one that said that the Japanese did it? Yeah. They did a pretty good job on that. But then, number 15. He next explained how industrial depressions and financial panic could be brought about and used to serve their purposes, saying, enforced unemployment and hunger imposed on the masses because of the power we have to create shortages of food will create the right of capital rule more surely than it was given to the real aristocracy and by the legal authority of kings. He claimed that by having their agentur control the mob could then be used to wipe out all who dared to stand in the way. Well, let's think about that. What about all the farms that are being taken away from the farmers in the Midwest? They're going to the big conglomerates. And we're talking about shortage of food. Right now, there's a shortage of food. There's 50 large grain elevators that are secretly hidden in the Midwest that are full of grain from the federal government. The federal government is storing them there. We have a shortage of food for the first time in years. People don't realize that there's only about a three-week backup in the supermarkets. And Kissinger at one time several years ago made the statement, if you want to control the population, you control the flow of food and the food supply. What does that do? If they make us hungry and starving, we're not going to be very good fighters, right? And then, of course, as far as financial panic is concerned, as I mentioned earlier, BCCI, billions of dollars lost, their savings and loan, and so forth. Item number 19. Diplomacy was next discussed. After all wars, secret diplomacy must be insisted upon in order that our agentur, masquerading as political, financial, and economic advisors, can carry out their mandates without fear of exposing who are the secret powers behind the national and international affairs. The speaker then told those present that by secret diplomacy, they must obtain such control, quote, that the nations cannot come to even an inconsiderable private agreement without our secret agents having it on hand. Number 20, the ultimate world government is the goal. To reach this goal, the speaker told them, it would be necessary to establish huge monopolies, reservoirs of such colossal riches that even the largest fortunes of the goyims will depend on us to such an extent that they will go to the bottom together with the credit of their governments on the day after the great political smash. The speaker then added, you gentlemen here present who are economists, just strike an estimate of the significance of this combination. I think that's happening to us today. Are you familiar with the meeting in San Francisco, September 27th, October 1st? Gorbachev, Bush led the charge. Margaret Thatcher was there to establish plans for a global civilization, his newspaper article to that effect. Number 21, economic war. Plans to rob the goyims of their landed properties and industries were then discussed. A combination of high taxes and unfair competition was advocated to bring about the economic ruin of the goyim as far as their national financial interests and investments were concerned. In the international field, he felt that he could be encouraged to price themselves out of the markets. They could be achieved by the careful control of raw materials, organized agitation among the workers for shorter hours and higher pay, and by subsidizing competitors. The Speaker warned his co-conspirators that they must arrange matters and control conditions so that the increased wages obtained by the workers will not benefit them in any way. What about NAFTA and GATT? In the oil industry, from the period of 1986 to 1992, there were at one point 4,000 oil rigs in the independent oil industry. There's less than 700 as of 1992. Instead of developing our own natural resources, the oil industry in this country, what we're doing, we're bringing them in at the rate of 15 million barrels per day in 12 supertankers out of the Middle East. And George Bush and his family, Zapata Oil Company, own a number of those supertankers. I've been told also by a CIA informant that they're not only bringing oil in those supertankers, but they're also bringing drugs in those supertankers. In the 26 years from 1946 to 1971, the U.S. trade surplus, I emphasize this, surplus, $98 billion. Economy grew at the rate of 4.8% per year. The national debt rose $148 billion. In a 23-year period from 1972 to 1994, the U.S. suffered a $1.6 trillion trade deficit. Economy grew 3.8%. The federal debt soared an annual rate of 3,200%, more than any preceding 26 years, by $4.3 trillion. NAFTA and GATT, they've put out vineyards out of business. I understand that there's a high unemployment rate in the San Diego area, and that the number of the companies are moving over into Mexico across the border, putting our people out of work. And we are losing jobs in this country at the rate of 16,300 jobs a week. So far since GATT and NAFTA have passed, American labor market has lost over 800,000 jobs. Item number 24, importance of youth. The importance of capturing the interests of youth was emphasized and admonition that our agenturas should infiltrate into all classes and levels of society and government for the purpose of fooling, bemusing, and corrupting the younger members of society by teaching them theories and principles we know to be false. Okay, let's talk about the youth for a while. How about these children in the Nebraska case? Paul Benassi, one of four children who refused to recant his signed statement, there were 80 children came forward in that case, said that he was part of an organized child kidnapping ring. When he was 10, 11, 12 years old, he was used as a decoy to attract other children in public locations, parks, malls, and so forth, over to the car, and the adults would grab them and throw them in the car. Reader's Digest, July 1982, more than 100,000 children disappear every year and are never heard from again. I'm not talking about runaway teenagers. I'm talking about 2, 3, 4, 5, 6-year-old kids. In the Nebraska case, Paul said that these kids are kept in safe houses across the country and ultimately auctioned off in Las Vegas, Nevada, an airstrip there, and also Toronto, Canada. And in this particular case, he said he's attended six such auctions in Las Vegas. The least number of children were six, the most were 36. The average kid, 10, 11, 12 years old, blue-eyed, blonde hair, sells for about $50,000. I wrote a letter to the Attorney General of the United States, William Barr, wrote a letter to the FBI, wrote a letter to the governor of the state of Nebraska, I wrote a letter to the Attorney General of the state of Nebraska, and I told him about this. And I told him, don't believe me, I only used to be in charge of the FBI in Southern California. Come see me, I'll give you my sources. You can talk to the people that I talked to, the people that gave me statements. And you know what, I received two responses. Number one, my sources were not credible. Number two, you don't have the proper documentation. I immediately documented my information and sent a 20-page document back. I have not received any response today. How about the McMartin case? Okay, everybody's familiar with that, being in this area. You are aware, of course, that the children said they were taken down in tunnels under the school, and they were taken through the tunnels up into the triplex next door, taken out into automobiles and prostituted. These are the 2, 3, 4-year-old children. And the authorities came in and said, well, I don't think these children are telling the truth. They're imagining this. And so they said they were fantasizing. And of course, we know what happened. Ray Buckey was hung jury twice out. Virginia, or the old lady, Miss McMartin, acquitted. Well, in the spring of 1990, I had an opportunity to gain control of the McMartin property. It had been sold from the McMartin family, the defense attorney, to a private contractor who was going to build an office on there. Thank you.
Thanks a lot. See some water back here.
And I signed a contract, assumed liability, and took a professional archaeologist in, Dr. Gary Stickle. We spent 34 days, 24 hours a day on that property. We guarded, of course, we didn't want anybody coming in and contaminating the evidence. And we found tunnels under the school. The authorities claimed they looked for tunnels, they couldn't find them. We found them. And as far as I'm concerned, the children were telling the truth. But as an outgrowth of this investigation, the McMartin family admitted to one of the mothers, I think it was Virginia McMartin, that she'd been all over the world setting up preschools because they were experts in this particular field. And Roland Summit, a prominent psychiatrist at UCLA, has made the statement in his research that there are at least 50 such schools across the country, preschools, where the children claim they were taken down into tunnels under the school. Now, in discussing the youth, I'd like to talk a little bit about the Finders case. I was able to gain access to an official Department of Treasury investigation, customs investigation, and I have it in front of me right now. And in 1987, the Tallahassee, Florida Police Department received a call, anonymous call, from a lady who said that there were two strange-looking men with six children in the park. They went out and checked the children out and saw the men. The men were well-dressed. The children were rather simply dressed. The children did not know how to use the toilet facilities or the telephone. The police arrested them. As a result of information in the van, they found the computer disks and so forth. The police sent the information to the Metropolitan Police Department in Washington, D.C. The Metropolitan Police, with search warrants, went out and checked the location where the children were kept and the warehouse where some of the activities supposedly took place. They found computer disks, and they found evidence of satanic cult activities and ceremonies. They found pornographic material. They found and documented that this Finders case involved the purchasing of children, trading of children, and kidnapping children all over the world. Locations which were observed and were contacted in connection with this international child ring, which also included information about terrorist activity and secret bank accounts, were London, Germany, the Bahamas, Japan, Hong Kong, Malaysia, Africa, Costa Rica, and Europe. The customs agent, very diligent and very conscientious in his efforts to find out what the problem was and get to the bottom of this, contacted the Metropolitan Police Department at the location where this search took place. And I'm looking right now at his final and closing memo, and I'm going to quote it. He went there to talk to them, the Metropolitan Police. I was advised that all the passport data had been turned over to the State Department for their investigation. There were some passports that were found not only in the warehouse but also in the van. The State Department in turn advised the Metropolitan Police that all travel and use of the passports by the holders of the passports was within the law and no action would be taken. This included travel to Moscow, North Korea, and North Vietnam from the late 1950s to the mid-1970s. Well, weren't we at war with those people in that period of time? Yes, we were. The individual further advised me of circumstances which indicated that the investigation into the activity of the Finders had become a, quote, CIA internal matter, end quote. The Metropolitan Police Department report has been classified secret and was not available for review. I was advised that the FBI had withdrawn from the investigation several weeks prior and that FBI Foreign Counterintelligence Division, that's headquarters, had directed the Metropolitan Police Department not to advise the FBI Washington Field Office of anything that had transpired. No further information will be available. No further action will be taken. By the way, the founder of the finders in my research, aside from this memo, is a CIA agent. You've heard of outcome-based education, I think, haven't you? That's another device that's being used to further deteriorate and destroy the mental capabilities of our children. There's a program called Vista Dome Signal. It's operating about six cycles away from the harmonic of the nation's power lines, and specifically phase-modulated to the exact frequency of all U.S. TV networks. This powerful and sinister mind control and behavioral modification signal is beamed to override all television programming 24 hours per day, and in subliminal fashion, bypassing the conscious mind into the TV viewer's living room. This is all coordinated by the National Bureau of Standards in Boulder, Colorado. For complete details of what the video drone signal ultimately does to those people most sensitive to it, see the movie Videodrome. It's thanks. This is in long-range writing. It's based on science fact, not science fiction. Have any of you seen that movie? You probably heard about this before then, huh? Here's an article about during the last 18 months, the government has been storing hundreds of tons of grain and other foodstuffs in some 50 secret underground facilities around the country. There are certain grain storage areas that are empty on a regular basis to the extent that there's hardly any grain available to the general public. Chips in the brain. This is a CIA operation. I have the documentation on it here. Project Gray Van, which is a super secret plan initiated by President Bush in 1991 to forcibly eliminate all Americans and other individuals who have been determined to be active opponents of the New World Order. Military personnel, highly trained in quick combat techniques such as SWAT team tactics, will be sanctioned to enter into a town or city and using computer listings locate those who are classified as dissidents to the New World Order. And there he is back there in the corner, right? I didn't think he'd bring a uniform tonight. And exterminate those people quickly and be gone within an hour or so. Are you familiar with, cybernetic organisms, I should say? Everybody should go out and buy one, I'm sure. How about using organisms? I'll get it right, okay. A human being who is part machine and fully automated as created secretly by NASA for deep space missions. I have a documentation on that also, and a number of other CIA programs. How are we doing on the time? Oh, I've got to, we got an hour and 15 minutes. I got 15 minutes for questions. Huh? Hour and 50? 15, okay. Okay, and then 15. Okay, the anti-terrorism legislation, I've said it publicly many, many times. This will create a situation that will deteriorate and destroy our constitutional rights and civil liberties. Let's go back to the initial writing of the bill. It was done under the Bush administration, set on the shelf. It didn't pass. One of the authors of the bill made the statement, people have to be killed before this will be passed. We had the World Trade Center bombing in 1993. October 28, 1993, New York Times and LA Times. An operative, this is documented in this article, an FBI operative in talking to his FBI handler made the statements and documented the fact that the FBI knew about the bombing that was to take place and did not prevent it from happening. I don't know about the rest of you, but when I was in the FBI, our ultimate goal in a case of that type was to protect the victims at all costs. We would never have allowed anything like that to happen, a bombing to have occurred. And then there were six people killed, $500,000 in damage. 1,000 individuals were injured, and the anti-terrorism bill did not pass. So along came April 19, 1995, and it is alleged that McVeigh and Nichols were involved in the bombing of the Oklahoma City building. I contended right from the beginning that was an incident created by this evil element, criminal element, within our government in order to pass the hasten the passage of the anti-terrorism legislation. I'm sure you're all very familiar with the latest developments, search without search warrant. The president can label the groups as terrorists, illegal taps, or legal as long as the police felt that they were acting in good faith, firearms sold today, using a robbery or a situation later on, 5 years, 6 years now, can result in the person who originally owned the firearms and going to jail, seizure of assets, secret evidence, you would not necessarily face your accuser in certain circumstances, and so forth. And you're familiar, I'm sure, since you are a well-educated group, with the survey that was taken at the Marine Corps, 29 Palms. One out of four GI said they would shoot their fellow Americans if they did not give up their firearms. Are you aware there's a bill in Congress for a United Nations tax right today? Before Bush signed, left office, he signed a treaty that would allow us to send our troops to overseas in the event of insurrection overseas, and foreign troops to come into the United States in the event of insurrections. And I have in front of me a Department of Army memo dated 29 August 1994, Army Draft Regulations on Civilian Inmate Labor Program. Enclosed for your review and comment is the Draft Army Regulation on Civilian Inmate Labor Utilization and Establishing Prison Camps on Army Installations. The draft regulation is the compilation of all policy, message, Civilian Inmate Labor Oversight Committee, policy decisions, and lessons learned to date. The new regulations will provide the following, and it goes on and it gives a number of points. Let's see, we're in California. We're going to have Ukrainian troops. Are there any Ukrainians in the room? I hope you know how to speak Ukraine. Ukrainian Hall, okay, good. Now, I don't know about you, I'm sure that you've seen from reading Spotlight and so forth that there have been allegations of thousands of UN troops in the United States. I was hesitant to accept that without personal knowledge. I talked to an individual who went out with the three other men. They heard that there were some troops down in Arizona. They went out and they claimed they found them and they saw them, and there were thousands of foreign troops there. Are you familiar with the executive orders that are in place today? Take over all communications, medians, petroleum, gas, minerals, transportation, control highways, government, education, et cetera, et cetera. Virtually a banking system, virtually take over the country. You're familiar with the Federal Execution Center in Terre Haute, Indiana? Brand new, it houses like 30 inmates. We haven't had a federal execution since 1963. You're familiar, I'm sure, with the many new prisons that are being built around the country. In Texas alone, they're building 36 new prisons. Janet Reno wants a national hit team that could operate any place in the United States, which will include civilian and military personnel, in violation of the Posse Comitatus Act. And basically, that's about what I have to say, except for, let me mention this. I announced my candidacy, as I said, in late November. And as a result of that, within 4 days, a fellow investigator from Washington, D.C. contacted one of my ex-girlfriends. I've been single for 22 years, so I'm not playing around on any wives or anything. Contacted one of my ex-girlfriends and interviewed her. The fellow's name is John Alexander. I made a call to Washington, D.C. John Alexander is a close associate of the White House administration. I can definitely prove that my telephones are tapped. I had a friend from L.A. who called me using one alias. He'd never used the alias before. Within 2 weeks after he made the call, his wife received a call wanting to know if the person by that name lived in that house. Ballot access. I was not given ballot access in Oregon or in Tennessee, and I was told I was not a viable candidate, and we asked what's a viable candidate, and we were told that a viable candidate is determined by the national media. In Colorado, we sent the money in. There was $500 fee, application money, met the deadline, and about 2 days before the ballots were printed, we received a notice that they would not place my name on the ballot. because I was not a viable candidate again, and they kept the $500, I might add. About 2 months ago, two CIA agents came to town, I learned through my sources, because there's, quote, some guy in Las Vegas running against Bill Clinton, he can do him a lot of harm, end quote. I had a potential business investor, and if this had gone through, I'd have had quite a bit of money in order to finance my campaign. It had been my personal money, by the way. And this investor was visited by two Secret Service agents. On February the 9th, I contacted WMUR ABC TV Manchester Channel 9, talked to Julie Campesino. We intended to, if this money had come through, put the Clinton Chronicles on that channel on a two-hour basis. I was, I'd given it a 13-minute introduction and about a four-minute closing, which made it 2 hours. We were told that the price was $20,000 for 2 hours. We called them back on February the 12th. That was Friday. We talked to them the first time. That second time was a Monday. The price was then $120,000. The Nevada caucus. Nevada is a caucus state. We called the Democratic headquarters in Nevada. We asked them, when would the caucus meeting be held? Because we wanted to send our representative there. We want Gunderson on the ballot in Nevada. They wouldn't tell us. We had to call the national headquarters in Washington, D.C. Wednesday before, two Sundays ago, and we learned that the caucus meeting was going to be a certain place, certain time, the following Sunday, 4 days later. We attended, some of our people attended. I was in Texas campaigning. And there were several applications to be placed on the ballot in addition to Bill Clinton. And the speaker accepted them but didn't do anything with them, and the only name on the ballot in Nevada will be Bill Clinton. There were three speeches, and that was it. There was no voting. By the way, I met with the head of the Nevada Democratic Party. I thought out of protocol, it would be nice to meet her and say hello to her. And I walked in, and she looked at me, and she says, oh, you're the candidate. I thought I had something on my tie. You know? And I said, yes. And so we sat down and started talking, and she said, why did you decide to run for president? And I said, well, I was in the FBI when it was a real organization. Wait a minute, she said. J. Edgar Hoover was gay. I said, no, he wasn't. And so I argued with her about that. And then in the end, she said, well, you have your opinion, I have mine. Then I went on to explain why I was running. And then later on, I said, well, do you have any advice? She said, yes, go get another job. And then later on, I said, can I expect any support from the Democratic Party? She said, no. I was scheduled for a forum with other presidential candidates in New Hampshire on February the 16th. It was on a Friday. Something told me the Thursday morning before I jumped on the plane that I should probably call. And I did, and I found out it had been dropped from the schedule without being notified. One of my campaign workers went to Florida to hook up with Terry Reid. I talked to Terry about giving his lecture up in New Hampshire. If my money had come through, I was going to use Terry, very frankly, and I'm not ashamed of it, to not campaign for me, but just to go out and lecture about drugs and Clinton's involvement in drugs. One of my campaign workers went to Florida to meet with some of Terry Reid's people, and he was beaten up and left for dead. I've had surveillances on me. My mail has been open, and I've been cut off a number of radio shows for no apparent reason. But anyway, I feel like, I think, of course, we all know that, has it been announced officially that Clinton has a candidacy? Well, the Democratic headquarters told us that he did. So just last week, I decided, I think it's time for me to change parties again. So I went over and I re-registered, and I'm a candidate for the Independent American Party, which is the Taxpayers' Party. And I'll tell you, I don't know if you see my platform, but it's identical with the Independent American Party platform. It's identical. I don't think there's much on there that you don't have, that I don't have, if that's who you are out there. So I think it's very, and I'm going to help them register as many people as I can. Probably be going to Arizona in another week or 10 days to help down there. It's important that we establish candidates at all levels, state, county, and the precincts and the districts. So now, before in closing, I'd like to mention I ran across this book, and it's a dynamite book. I didn't author it. I've written the book, How to Locate Anyone Anywhere Without Leaving Home. And I had an opportunity to talk to Galen Ross Sr. when I went through San Marcos, Texas. And he has a brand new book that's called Who's Who of the Elite. And it identifies the members of the Bilderbergs, Council on Foreign Relations, Trilateral Commission, Skull and Bone Society, and the Committee of 300. And it's a little expensive. It sells for $30. But I'm telling you, I think it's worth it. And what I think you should do, if you have the $30, is buy this book and sit down. When you watch television, look up these names alphabetically, and I think you'll be surprised to learn how many of these people are in positions of authority and influence. Anyway, that's my time. Thank you very much. You might hold it up? Yeah. This is available, by the way, through our office. We also have a number of other books that are available: Corruption, Satanic Cult Drug Network, The Mystery of the Carefully Crafted Hoax, How to Locate Anyone Anywhere Without Leaving Home. Patty helped type on that, I think, Patty, didn't you? And by the way, it's great to see some of my old friends out here. Thank you very much for coming. Is that it? Thanks a lot.
Ted.
We're going to do the questions now, Ralph? Yeah, okay. Okay, anybody who has a question, Ralph will try to get the microphone to you, or go back and see Ralph right now, because we want to get it recorded so we can hear.
Thank you, Mr. Gunderson, for coming tonight. That was very interesting. You said that you had proof of tunnels at the McMartin School. Do you have photographs or videotapes?
Yes, we have photographs, and we have a preliminary report back there, don't we, Raymond? Ray Duran? Do we have the McMartin preliminary report back there? Do we have the McMartin preliminary report back there? We don't have. We've got it in our office. And we have the scientific report, which is about 186 pages long. Yes, we do have it. We have photographs.
All right. Thank you, sir.
There were a lot of pictures taken by the TV people, by the way. And those would be available if you want to request them.
Sometime in about the last 12 months, there was on public TV, showing a thing. It's called Jihad America. Is this any truth to this, or is this just a drummed-up thing?
You'll have to enlighten me as to what Jihad America is.
Jihad America was a extremist Islamic groups that's trained in martial arts and trained as to how to use weaponry of all kinds.
I don't know anything about it. I'm sorry.
You know, it's supposedly some undercover agents of the FBI or the CIA went in and gathered this evidence. It was on public TV within the last 16 months.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I don't know anything about that.
Excuse me one minute. We're taking up a collection for Ted for his campaign. Rich has got a bucket back here. He'll be passing it around. So we'd like everybody to donate to his campaign.
Hey, thanks a lot. Well, that's great. Yeah. That'll pay a few telephone bills, I hope.
Yes, every time that there's a proposed piece of gun legislation, you'll have an incident where somebody will kill a bunch of people. And all of a sudden, they'll point and say, this is the reason we need to have this gun legislation. But every time they investigate these incidents, they find invariably the person that perpetrated the killings was on Prozac or some kind of a psychoactive drug. Do you have any information on that, or could you enlighten us about that?
Yes, I can. I have a paper about 3 inches thick of all the various CIA programs, and one of them includes mind control and people that are trained to go out and create these incidents and hasten the passage of anti-gun legislation.
Yes, sir. Are you familiar with this FBI criminal espionage investigation of the CFR?
Yes, I am.
Being foiled, okay.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I am. Are you selling that back there?
No, I just, this is part of a collection. Mm-hmm. I just wondered if you had any information.
I'm familiar with that. Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah, and one of my old buddies in high school is a member of the CFR, by the way. He quit speaking to me the last time I ran into him back at the hometown. Yes, Peter? Yes, okay, that's a good idea. My phone number in Las Vegas is 702-262-6410. 702-262-6410. Do we have any literature back there, Ray Duran, with our phone number on it? We do? Okay. If you, on the way out the door, you can grab that literature. You can get all our books, yes. We have, what we have is How to Locate Anyone Anywhere, The Mystery of the Carefully Crafted Hoax, which is the Nebraska case, The Plan by Paul Fisher, who was a candidate in 1960 against Jack Kennedy, The Finder's Report, the official customs report, which I read today, and the Oklahoma City Bombing Report. Total package is $50 plus mailing, $5, $55. We have a three-volume set, caption, Corruption, Satanic Cult, Drug Network. It's a total of $55, which kind of encompasses a lot of the material that I gave you here tonight, but documents it. We have the Clinton Chronicles, which sells for $30, with mailing and handling to be $35. And we have a new video out, and I encourage you to buy it. It's called the Gunderson Chronicles. And it's also $35 for handling. And we have Suzanne Harris. Is Suzanne here, Peter?
No, she's not.
Oh. Suzanne Harris, very prominent attorney from the Law Loft. I'm interviewing her for 30 minutes. I'm interviewing, and we're talking about legislation and treaties that have been passed and handed on down and with the, looking toward the goals of the New World Order. Also to a gentleman who talks about executive orders. And by the way, executive orders are unconstitutional, totally unconstitutional. They were originally designed in order to pass directive orders down to department heads, not down to the public or not to the people. And the other lady is Karen Bickman, who talks about the big federal land grabs. And these are all available. And then this elite book sells for $30. Yes.
Ted, you faxed to me a step-by-step plan to return to constitutional government.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I went out and made copies of that. So if anybody's interested in having Mr. Gunderson's plan to return to constitutional government, here's a step-by-step on how to, with information number and fax number at the bottom of the sheet. And I made plenty of these copies at the back of the room. And
thank
I want
to
make a personal comment here. At great personal sacrifice, Ted has been traveling around the country, and it's not been easy for him. Now, irregardless of realistically whether he wins this presidency or not, he is performing an invaluable service to us patriots, educating the people. Thank you.
Thank you. Hey, I realize it's a long shot. I realize it's a real long shot, but and if we could get a good man up there, I'm going to keep running, by the way. I'm going to run right up to the end. I hope that means the campaign, by the way. I'm going to run right up to the end, but if somebody as a constitutionalist steps forward and I think he's better than I am or can beat me, I'll step aside for him. It's very, very important, critical, that we get somebody in the White House and get rid of these people that are throwing these things down our throat and destroying our whole civilization. By the way, I have something on my platform nobody else does, and that is to get rid of the Federal Reserve System. And furthermore, get rid of the IRS, get rid of the Department of Education. And I have a tax, but you've heard of the flat tax, the square tax, the rectangular tax, right? Well, I got the best of all, believe me. Yeah, let me just tell you about my tax plan. It's dynamite, and it'll cure our problems. What you do is you eliminate all income tax for everybody. Yeah. Now, what happens there is the middle income and lower income bracket people spend what? Let's face it, we all spend what? 100% of what we earn, right? So by eliminating your income tax, you automatically have a 20 to 40% raise. That puts $2 billion a day into circulation. With $2 billion a day going into circulation, it's calculated to have 20 million new jobs. You'd have prosperity in this country like you never had before. You'd have jobs for the homeless. You'd have jobs for people on welfare. You'd have new jobs for labor. Okay? So how do you finance the government? Well, of course, we have tariffs and commerce, as the Constitution allows. But also, what I propose is that you have a $200,000 deductible. We're going to let the rich pay, okay? And you tax the assets above $200,000. Like 3 1/3 of $60 trillion would be $2 trillion in income per year. Well, the rich shouldn't complain because, after all, with $2 billion a day going into circulation, their assets are automatically going to go up. So they're going to be making more money. Their assets are going to be greater, so they shouldn't be upset at all about that. Okay. Anyway, I didn't. Did I tell you how I came out? And I talked earlier. Let me just mention how I came out in New Hampshire. I came in 12th out of 21. I think I did. I mention that. Did I mention in Texas where I didn't? Okay. In Texas, I went down. I campaigned almost 3 weeks. I was by myself. I attended as many Democratic rallies as they would allow me to get into the where they'd allow me in the building, and they. There was another lady that helped me. We spent less than $2,500, had no advertising. We were mainly on the radio talk shows, and we came away with between 30 and 35,000 votes. And that's it's not a final figure. That's projected figure based on 28% of the precincts that reported. So we have to be very pleased. I'm pleased with that. That means that there's 30 to 35,000 people out there listening to me, and I was saying to those people, the same as I talked on Peter's show, and thanks, Peter, for making your show available to all of us and our cause and so forth. This man deserves a round of applause. And by the way, he's married to a lady whose maiden name was Gunderson. Yeah, there she is. There she is, Miss America. Okay. Anyway, I think we did pretty well in Texas. I'm pleased. I'm just sorry I couldn't get on more ballots. Yes, another question.
Yes, sir. You mentioned the Franklin cover-up in 1989.
Yes.
Could you tell me how to obtain documentation that Bush's attendance of one of those?
How we obtained it?
Yeah, no, sir. His the documentation that he attended.
Yes, the documentation is from several of the children who attended the parties. And I have personally have a videotape from a kid who saw him at one of those parties. This is in the book, by the way, in Franklin cover-up book. You know, I was on a radio show in Las Vegas not too long, and I named these names, Harold Anderson, Bob Wadman, da-da-da, and so on and so forth. And right after the show, some fellow called the station. He said he wanted a copy of that tape. Well, I know what he was doing. He was planning on having me sued for naming these people. And I know that, of course, his research indicated that they'd already been named. And by the way, John Franklin challenged these people. He couldn't get anybody to write it to to publish his book, The Franklin Cover-Up. He said, I beg you to sue me, he said to him publicly. They wouldn't sue him. And of course, they didn't want to sue him because all this information would be made public then. Right, yes, question.
Hi, yes. I've heard a rumor for the past 10 years, and this time the source was a man by the name of John Lair who claims that the attempted assassination of Ronald Reagan in 81 was orchestrated by the same people who did Kennedy through a Manchurian candidate. Do you know anything about that?
I don't have any documentation, but I've heard similar stories. And for years, I've went along with the Warren Commission report on the Kennedy assassination until I saw where Dr. Cyril Specht, or not Cyril Specht, Wecht, Cyril Wecht out of Pittsburgh, said that, who was in part of the autopsy, I believe, said that there was more than one gunman. And I know Cyril Wecht. In fact, I've had him work on two of my homicide cases that I've worked in the past. And he's probably one of the most renowned pathologists in the country. And I'll take his word for it against the Warren Commission any day. And yet I went along with the party line all those years, and I must have blinders on. But of course, I was being fed the propaganda that you're given. But the FBI, I can understand. We had 164 categories which we were responsible for. And if information came to our attention within those 164 categories, we investigated. If it didn't, we put it in what we called the zero file. So I don't blame the FBI agents, per se. It was only after I became involved in the McDonald case and another number of other cases, the McMartin case, and the Victor Glushin bombing and the Marina del Rey, a bomb under the front seat in the gas tank, two bombs, the FBI, ATF, and the sheriff's office all said it was suicide. And $2 million of insurance we were brought in, our firm was brought in. We established homicide without any doubt. 6 out of 7 insurance companies paid. We went to trial for the 7th Old Republic of Chicago, and we won in a trial. They said the judge ruled in our favor that he was murdered. There was not suicide. I call it suicided, right? But anyway, that's another story. But then more recently, the Oklahoma City bombing, there's no question in my mind that John Doe 2 is an agent and/or an informant or an operative for the federal government. Yes, question.
Ted, you mentioned earlier Project Gray Van. Can you just give us a few more details on that?
That's the assassination?
On Project Gray Van specifically.
Yeah, I'll read what I have here. I don't think I read it all. These are longhand notes. That's why I messed up on whatever. I won't say it again. I'll read the whole memo. Some of these memos I didn't read completely. I just skimmed them. If I can find it. Project Gray Van is a super secret plan initiated by President Bush in 1991 to forcibly eliminate all Americans and other individuals who have been determined to be active opponents of the New World Order. Military personnel highly trained in quick combat techniques such as SWAT team tactics will be sanctioned to enter into a town or city and using computer listings locate those who are classified as dissidents to the New World Order and to exterminate these people quickly and be gone within an hour or so, moving from city to city in such a manner as to not leave much trace for local authorities to follow. The plan is to claim these people eliminated were involved in drug dealings and that it was merely part of a drug war and to keep the information out of the news media. That's all I have on it. Now, let me just mention one other thing. I met with a CIA agent not too long ago, and we were in a restaurant, and he was filling me in on some information, giving me details about CIA activity, and he started crying. And he told me that for years he thought he was solving a problem, and all of a sudden he woke up one day and he realized he was the problem. And he said that of all the horrible things that he's done, and I know he's killed people, he said it's really starting to bother him. He said he has splitting headaches constantly, he can't sleep at night, and he's really, I don't know what's going to happen to him. I told him he had to go see a psychiatrist. But there's two groups in the CIA. There's the good old boys who realize that the orders they were given were not of humanitarian and in the best interests of those of us who we consider ourselves Christians. And then there's a new kid on the block. And the old timers are working diligently and are in competition with the new kid on the block. And these are the young guys out of college and so forth who are doing all the professional assassinations and the killings today. And there are two, I think CIA is like the mafia. Once you're in, you're in. And you're never identified, but two of them have told me that we're the biggest terrorists in the world and the biggest drug dealers in the world. Yes, question.
Yes, thank you for coming. I have a comment and a question. By way of personal experience, a couple of years ago, I did attend an American Independent Party convocation for purpose of, it was more like a business meeting, and there was definitely pro-skinhead white supremacist literature on the table for distribution and pickup, so I want you to be cautioned to keep your eyes open for that kind of stuff. You don't want that mud slinging on yourself.
I appreciate that.
Okay.
They've called me other things already, so it doesn't matter. Clinton put out the word I'm a homosexual.
Yeah, you need to distance yourself from that kind of stuff. Okay. Secondly, question. Do you take Michael Reconosciuto to be credible?
Absolutely.
Spotlight last year printed a story that where he was quoted through you as saying that was my bomb. Do you take that as a true story?
Absolutely, meaning that he developed that bomb.
Okay, so you stand by that.
Yes.
You also believe that he was on the October surprise flight and also that he was...
Let me answer that first question. Let's come back to those last two questions.
Okay.
We know the bomb. We have the contract number. It's manufactured by Dinah Nobel in Salt Lake City. We have written a letter to the Department of the Army asking for details based on the contract number. We have not received a response. I just can't understand that, by the way. Yes, there's no question about that, in my opinion. And what was the other question?
Well, he also said that he was part of the
Well, I don't know about the October surprise flights, but I know he's part of the Inslaw problem. I have personal knowledge of that, and I have the affidavits, and I've talked to Bill Hamilton. You're familiar with the Inslaw, the $10 million heist of the computer system. Bill Hamilton, Promise Software. Yes, ma'am.
I have a question which really has two parts. Do you know anything about the Delta Force or the Fifth Column Group and their plan to restore us to the gold standard? Also, in connection with that, there was an article that appeared in the Ventura County paper just this week, and I understand it's creeping out all over the nation, where a group claims Texas independence, the restoration to the independent nation status, and many states have declared that and have the paperwork and everything in process to reclaim independent status. Would you comment about those two things?
The first question was on the fifth column, Delta Group, fifth column. I'm sure you're familiar that the fifth column is computer wizards who have gotten into the bank accounts in the Switzerland, and they're supposedly handing copies of the bank accounts back to the congressmen, senators, the politicians, saying resign or be exposed. I don't know exactly which senators and congressmen have been identified, but I have confirmed that through my CIA contacts, that those men do exist, and as a matter of fact, I'm not a direct contact with them, but I'm one layer away from them. So I do have that confirmed, that Jim Nichols, or Jim Norman is telling the truth. I don't know anything about the gold standards. I know that I would have to say that these men are patriotic Americans. These are probably the good old boys. There's supposed to be three of them active, one of them is injured, and one of them died. The independent nation status, several days ago, over the weekend, I think it was, 18th, 2,000 people marched on the state capitol and demanded that Bush vacate his office in Austin, Texas. And another 2,000 joined them and went on over to IRS and told IRS to get out of the state of Texas.
Okay, we collected $173 here for Ted's campaign, and we want to thank him for coming here tonight and answering all the questions and telling us all of these things. Let's give him a round of applause.
Thanks a lot. But I'm going to... thanks a lot. You've seen this, and you've seen this. And what are the others that they do? I forget. But Bill Clinton goes like this every once in a while. Well, mine is this, right? Thank God we're all free. Let's hope we can stay that way.
Ted, yes. We've completed the audio, but we got some more questions, so you want to hang on?
Sure, I'll stay all night. It doesn't matter. I'm just driving back to Las Vegas. I got gas money.
Mr. Gunderson, since you were with the FBI, I just want to know if there were some underground naval bases in the east and west coast, if you know anything about them, and maybe in the island of New Georgia.
I've heard about them. I don't know anything about them. I understand that we have an oil reserve in Bakersfield. There's a lot of controversy up there that the government's selling it off, and it's the oil reserve for the naval fleet. Do you anybody know anything about that? You heard that?
The dome or something?
Yeah, I don't know anything about that. I'm sorry, I don't know anything about the underground naval. Sorry about that.
Dad, I have a question. I met with a producer not too long ago who was asked to view an 8mm video tape, which was shot of the Murray Building in Oklahoma about halfway up. And she was asked by some Army personnel to verify, was the tape tampered, altered, anything? What it basically showed was a helicopter landing on the Murray Building. Several, I think she said five people dressed in jumper fatigue clothes getting out of the helicopter, disappearing. She saw only from the waist up because of the parapet wall at the top. They disappeared, and if I'm not mistaken, they were gone for 6 minutes. It came back, got into the helicopter. Helicopter took off, and I think it was 3 minutes later the building implodes. And I'm wondering if you've heard anything. She asked, can I have a copy of the tape? And the personnel said, do you want to live? And she said, yes. And he said, forget it. Anyway, have you heard of such a tape, anything like this?
No, I have not. I'm sorry. Right. I haven't heard about it. I'd like to get my hands on it, though.
Yeah, I would just like to comment. In this paper that's at the back of the table, the Reality Press, we have a pretty good coverage of the Texas Republic. And next month, which will be out the 4th, we're updating. There were three indictments served, one on the IRS, one on the de facto state, and one on George Bush. So these are free. They're in the back of the room.
Ted, I'd like to get this on record. Senator
Your
Dole.
Name, your name, sir? Go ahead.
Senator Dole ran for vice president with Gerald Ford in 1976. He replaced Rockefeller when Rockefeller went off. According to a mutual friend, Kathy O'Brien, and she was part of when she was part of the MK Ultra Project Monarch program, being used as a sex slave, did not, in fact, to the best of your knowledge, Senator Dole's running mate, Gerald Ford, force her to have oral copulation or perform oral copulation upon him when she was a mere child?
Kathy O'Brien?
Yes.
Well, she said every living president except Jimmy Carter had sex with her.
Yeah. So there's no question about that.
Well, that's what she told me.
Now, there has been rumors that Gerald Ford was a practicing Satanist.
And
you have heard about that?
Yes.
Do you think that there's anything to back that up?
I don't have any documentation on it, only what I've been told, what I've heard.
And then she stated that while in the company of the Clintons, that not her, but her husband had an affair with Bill Clinton. Is that correct?
Yes, she mentioned that. She said that.
Anal intercourse or something of that nature.
Right.
Or oral copulation.
That's what yes. I understand.
And still one other thing.
Yeah.
That Hillary Clinton was interested in her, the shape of her vagina, or there was some mutilation. And I know this all sounds rather bizarre, but this is a very bizarre and very true story. And that Hillary Clinton wanted to take her on and did. Is that correct?
That's what she says. By the way, I have the book here.
Is, to the best of your knowledge, is Hillary Clinton AC and DC?
Well, just what Kathy's told me.
Yes. Mm. Do you have any other verification?
I don't have any personal experience there.
Yeah. we've had private conversations, and you stated that there might be other women who would testify to that.
There are, to my knowledge, I've been told there are five presidential models. That's what they call them. These are very pretty, attractive ladies who are from birth trained to be sex slaves to presidents and top dignitaries in the government. And there are five of them living today. I have personally met with two of them.
And they would testify to having affairs with the first lady, would probably like to be the first man.
Of course, Kathy will. The other one is in hiding. Mm-hmm. And the other three, I've not talked to them. I think maybe someday I will. I'm not
Do you
sure.
fear if this story is not revealed that Kathy's life might not be a long one?
That's right. And the women who, the three ladies who are in hiding, fear for their life. They have not come forward, and I don't know that they ever will. The other lady who has given me a statement on video, and also a signed statement, she's not advertising, but, you know, I have talked to her.
Did Kathy not, in fact, state that her your 4-year-old child was first molested by a pedophile president named George Bush.
That's right.
Okay. Mm. Thank you.
You have pretty good memory, Anthony.
I'm keeping a close tab on our Reichstag 95, and it seems to be doing very well in exposing the bad guys, and as a consequence, we had a delay in the anti-Bill of Rights bill, and we have to do something about that right now. And I think Peter, wherever Peter is, and Suzanne Harris has been on top of this particular legislation. We have to put the kibosh to it right now, and you're invited again on my show.
Good, thank you.
Maybe tomorrow night.
All right, good, okay. Thanks. Anthony, I'm sure everybody knows who Anthony is, and Peter. Peter and Suzanne Harris are great Americans. They've done a fabulous job at the Law Loft, researching and so forth. Yes, sir.
Another one of our biggest problems in this country is the fact that we have a corrupt judiciary system. We have a Justice Department who will only stand up for the government and is not interested in justice for the people, only in keeping the government out of trouble. We have judges that can't be sanctioned in any way. This is not constitutional, but they seem to have been able to make up their own code to keep themselves from being prosecuted. I'd like to have your feelings on this.
Yes. I've seen it time and time again in the last 16 years, first with the Jeffrey McDonald case, Judge Dupree. There were 24 motions entered by the defense, and all but one were denied, and there were 8 entered by the prosecution, and all were accepted by the judge. Evidence was destroyed, evidence was altered. I have a summary of that case. I think if you have never read it, I'd suggest that you call my office and we'll get a copy to you that just documents corruption right from the beginning. And that judge, no question about it, was very partial and prejudiced against Dr. McDonald. That was an Army drug cover-up. There's no question about it. I've seen it also on a number of occasions in cases that I've worked where you have child custody cases. And the perpetrator, or the one who molests the kid, oftentimes is given the child over the straight and the honest parent, even though it's proven that the honest parent is the one that should have the kid. Yes?
Well, it seems to me that if we don't get the judiciary straightened out, we'll never be able to bring any of the government officials under any scrutiny and get any problems solved in this country, as they'll just keep on going and covering it up, and it goes on and on infinitum.
That's right.
Some years back in research, there was indication from my research that the entrance into the underground cities is through the petroleum buildings in each city. Do you know anything about that?
No, I don't. I'm sorry.
At that time, I believe that they... And I don't have this positively verified, but I believe that they have a card, a certain card, and that will admit them into the underground cities.
They have the CIA has a device, or the government, I don't know if it's CIA or not.
Okay.
They can go through solid rock at the rate of 5 miles an hour. Okay. and build a big tunnel.
Well, the
huge tunnel, take a train through it.
Yeah. The genealogy, if you're interested in the genealogy of George Bush and all the people involved, goes right back through to the same people involved with assassination of all our presidents. Lincoln's stepmother was Sarah Bush Johnston of the Bush banking family at the time.
In response to Anthony's questions whether Hillary is AC or DC, I can assure him that she is. I have inside information on that. She was caught dead in the act in the White House. My second question for you is on Dr. Jeffrey McDonald. What is the status on him now?
Jeffrey McDonald?
Yes.
Dr. McDonald is still serving 3 consecutive life sentences. He's lost 3 or 4 appeals. I forget, there's so many I forget. The attorneys supposedly claim that they're working on another appeal now. and that's it. We're in the process of, if any of you ever read Fatal Justice, not Fatal Vision, but Fatal Justice, the book out by Jerry Potter, it tells the true story of the McDonald case, and there's a movie that's being produced on that.
I hadn't read Fatal Justice, but I have read the Fatal Vision, which was kind of a slanted left.
Well, Fatal Vision was fiction.
That's right.
They only mentioned my name in there three times. Fatal Justice mentioned it throughout the book. So. Go buy Fatal Justice.
Are you aware that he was kept in solitary confinement several years?
Yeah, and what, sir?
He was kept in solitary confinement for several years.
Yes.
I don't know if he still is or not.
No, he's not, but he was. And there was an attempt on his life in jail, too. Ultimate evil.
Those folks, the few of you that might know who I am, I'm reasonably selective in my friends at this point in time, for those of you that know why. Okay, I consider Ted and I are very good friends. If I made a list of 15 or 20 people out of all the people in the United States of America, okay, that are really out there, that have a big pair of eyes like he does to step forward to be able to do this, that's the wrong part of the anatomy. Ted would be really top, maybe in the top 10 out of all the people that are out here trying to kick tail on these bad guys. And I want you guys to realize something. I mean, some of us, you know, we're all crazy, the guys that are out in front anyhow. Obviously, we're all mental retards or something. There's something wrong with us. But you have to understand, it takes a lot of guts to have all the time in that he has had in the FBI and to come forward, you know, and do his numbers like he does. So I hope you really appreciate it. And I respect Ted at a real high level compared, because we got a lot of jerks out here, and Ted is not one of them.
Thanks, Bob. Bob deserves a lot of respect, too. If you might just very briefly tell them about the attempt to kill you.
We've already done that. They know
the
it.
Poison.
The bulk of these characters already know, I think, I really appreciate it. I won't go into the whole thing again, but next time I'm talking, you can speak in here. Most of these are all friends, Ted, so I guess they're filled in. Listen, on the reconosciuto thing, this gentleman asked about reconosciuto and his veracity and whether he's straight up or down or not. Many years ago, in 1988, I was directly involved with the Innslaw investigations, and reconosciuto was directly involved with making the alterations on that stolen computer that Edwin Meese and Reagan's people were involved with. That's all straight up and down. I would say that reconosciuto's information is probably 98% correct, and the 2% would only be an error. I think he's completely straight, the same as Ted does. Wow. Thanks for coming. Bye,
yeah,
Ted.
Yeah, thanks. No. Thanks, Bob.
What? Oh, one more? Okay.
Just a quick question for Ted. In my readings regarding other former federal government employees, CIA operatives and military intelligence guys and stuff, a lot of them are afraid to come forward and talk because of the secrecy agreements they've signed and subtle threats that are made against, you know, their pensions and in many cases, you know, out and out threats. And I was just curious if you've had any of that kind of pressure on yourself.
Yes, I have. I've never divulged any secrets that I knew when I was in the FBI. Everything that I've told you tonight I developed after I left the FBI, so I don't have any obligation to keep it quiet. Also, I was asked last fall by the Society of Former Special Agents of the FBI to explain why I have made certain critical remarks of the FBI, and they specifically directed my attention to six or eight statements I've made publicly, including that the FBI is corrupt. And they said either recant or resign, and if you don't resign, we're going to expel you. And I took every statement and I documented when I made it and where the documentation was. I furnished it along. I submitted a document about 4.5-5 inches thick to back up my statements. And I haven't heard from them since. I'm still a member of the Society of Former Special Agents of the FBI. But in the letter, I told them, I said, it's very obvious to me that this inquiry was directed by the FBI itself and not by the Society. And I said, ensure that the FBI itself receives a copy of this response. Okay? Now, in the Oklahoma City bombing, I immediately furnished the results of my investigation to the FBI, to Arlen Specter, to Stephen Jones, McVeigh's attorney, to ICI Explosives in Dallas. Immediately furnished it to them. And of all of those agencies and or groups that received the results of my investigation, and I begged the FBI to come see me, and I begged Arlen Specter's committee to come interview me. Of all of those, only Stephen Jones and investigators came and interviewed me. You see, the thing is, if the FBI would just come to see me, I would just sit down with my tape recorder and tell them all the things that I said tonight, and I would tell them where they can go to get the documentation. In fact, I'd furnish them the documentation. But they don't want to talk to me because they don't want to hear this, because they don't want to have to be placed in a position where they might have to do something about it. It's that simple. And I know that. And I'm just begging them to come see me. Please, FBI. Have you got any plants here tonight, by the way? Come see me. I don't know what's going to happen. I have no way of determining that at this point.
Ted, just one more quick thing. Has Jeffrey McDonald ever considered writing a book from his standpoint, what happened in his case?
No, he had. He hired Joe McGinnis to write the first book, and he thought it was going to be pro-McDonald, and it ended up being just the opposite. And he sued McGinnis for and obtained an out-of-court settlement of $325,000. And then the latest was Jerry Potter, and Jeff helped on that version of Fatal Justice by Jerry Potter. But as far as I'm concerned, they didn't tell the whole story. I'm gonna write a book someday, and I'll tell the whole story.
Okay, this closes our program. Let's give Ted a big hand for all the wonderful information and taking a stand like he has.
Thanks a lot, folks. Enjoyed being here.
Appreciate that. God bless you.
For anybody who wants a...